1 year ago, on October 10, 2018, in Mexico Beach, Florida, Hurricane Michael, a Category 5 on the five-tiered Saffir-Simpson scale, hit the Florida panhandle with massive force.
You know, in our public information officer training, FEMA does a magnificent job of the advanced public information officer class. And in that class, they throw everything at you, and you sit there and you're like, ha-ha, this is never going to happen in real life. But it really happened where we lost all communications. We lost all our infrastructure. It was unbelievable.
With winds up to 160 miles an hour, Hurricane Michael was the fourth strongest hurricane ranked by wind to hit the continental United States.
You know, I think from a larger scale, scientifically, we need to really start making bigger strides in terms of understanding and predicting rapid intensification. And I think that's something that will help us, you know, maybe buy us another 12 hours the next time that we're facing with the catastrophic impacts. I think 12 more hours would have made a big difference with Hurricane Michael. Even something that spun up so quickly, if we had been talking Cat 4 or Cat 5 12 hours earlier, I think that would have made a difference. To get there, we've still got to make some scientific advances.
To put this in perspective, 80 to 95 mile per hour winds can sweep a person off their feet. After you reach 130 miles per hour and beyond, breathing is almost impossible.
I think the one thing that got everyone's attention collectively was the fact that everyone's ears started popping as the eye wall approached. The pressure started dropping. This hurricane had the third lowest pressure on record at landfall, so that was something that a lot of people commented on.
Barometric pressure, simply put, is the weight of the air. It is the force of gravity pulling it to the earth. The lack of pressure in the eye of a hurricane pulls the wind in and around.
So storm surge is caused from the strong winds that are moving around the hurricane. As the storm moves closer to the coast, it pushes water along the coastline, and that water begins to pile up and then move over the beaches into the normally dry areas. What makes storm surge so especially dangerous is that people tend to underestimate the force of moving water. We talk about only about a foot of water to immobilize a car, but you start envisioning 2 to 4 feet of moving water with a person trying to stand, it's very easy to see why flooding, and particularly storm surge flooding, is so deadly during tropical cyclones. Also, when we add battering waves on top of this storm surge, that can easily destroy structures. And so when you're talking about surge that's greater than 6 to 10 feet with the waves on top of it, it's easy to see why we had such significant destruction in our coastal communities during Hurricane Michael.
Prior to the hurricane making landfall, many citizens across the panhandle evacuated. Others decided to stay, batten down the hatches, and prepare.
A lot of people ask if they're vulnerable to storm surge or if they really should leave when a storm is approaching the coast. It's very important that folks listen to the advice of their emergency management officials. Storm surge is very destructive. It's very track dependent as well. It can happen very quickly as the storm is making landfall. You don't want to be in a position that you're waiting to when the water rises to evacuate. That's why we encourage folks to leave before the storm arrives. You can learn pre-season if you're in an evacuation zone from your local county emergency management officials and have that plan in place if they call an evacuation for your area and be prepared to go.
And Mexico Beach was certainly one of those first stages because they're right on the coast, and it was anticipated that the storm would be in that area. We didn't know exactly where the landfall would be, but so those warnings were given out, and to my knowledge, the majority of the people heeded those warnings. There were some that stayed back. Off the top of my head, I don't have those exact numbers, but there were a large number of people who did leave the area.
In hindsight, I think that other communities need to start much earlier preparing their citizens. I mean, we do outreach, but preparing their citizens for what the unthinkable really looks like, especially now that we know, and following up with the Bahamas. I mean, it's just what happens to you if all of this just falls apart. People need to be more prepared.
Behind the scenes, emergency management officials work day and night alongside embedded National Weather Service meteorologists, coordinating with their local office in Tallahassee and the National Hurricane Center located in Miami, Florida.
We actually physically deployed meteorologists to local EOCs, including the one over in Bay County, which is where the landfall occurred. We also deployed a meteorologist to the Leon County EOC and right here on the Florida State Campus EOC.
Everyone involved in support of this event worked diligently throughout the days and nights leading up to and after landfall, providing up-to-date information as it became available.
We also need to do better, and other agencies need to do better too, is making sure that their citizens understand what the official sources for information are. There was so much rumor, there was so many pop-up social media pages, things that looked official, and we spent, as public information officers, so much time knocking down rumors that no, Home Depot's not giving away free generators, no, you can't go take a shower at the destroyed Panama City Police Department. And so we have citizens that are out and about wasting their gas, stuck in traffic, going for rumors, and that is a huge challenge. So I think that before any event, we need to be working very hard with our media partners. Who is your official source? Who do you need to look to after disaster, that these are the people that you're going to take the word for it? And we've identified that.
Even with the preparedness, the impacts were wide-reaching, devastating for many.
Another extremely tough conversation was with our first responders. When they came to the point of you can no longer respond, or immediately after the storm when they were chomping at the bit to get out there and do what they're called to do, and we were having to tell them, no, you've got to wait until it's safe. You've got to follow the process. We can't get you out there and get you hurt. But all they wanted to do was go rescue their citizens, go do what their job is. And that was extremely difficult for them.
The devastation and impacts from Michael extended well inland, still classified as a Category 2 hurricane as it crossed into southwest Georgia.
You know, thinking back on it, really getting people to understand just how bad it was really going to be. And we talked about it in our interviews. I don't think that anyone, even internally, really was visualizing the kind of devastation and destruction that we saw over our inland counties. So I think communicating that to folks was a big part of what we were really focusing on.
I knew it was going to be bad, but I don't think the human mind can conceive of what it was going to be. My number one concern was thinking about people that were along the coast. We thought surge was going to affect more people than it actually did. I never thought of what the tree canopy was going to do to our entire, several counties around here. I just never had a clue of what it was going to look like.
Without a point of reference, many people can't relate to a storm of this magnitude.
The number one thing that I was worried about was that, you know, concerned about naturally was the how it was, the death toll, the way it was going to affect people. So that was, you know, that was certainly at the top of my mind and many others as well. Did the warnings that we put out, did the warnings that all of the emergency management put out, did people listen to that and actually react and do what they were supposed to do by getting out of harm's way? And so that was on my mind quite a bit.
Directly or indirectly, 59 fatalities were attributed to Michael. Even now, recovery efforts are ongoing. Some areas will never be the same, and many lives were changed forever. We are not immune to major hurricanes. Catastrophic impacts from hurricanes will eventually be felt again, even for those not directly along the coast.
I mean, every year, we're going to be looking over our shoulder with the potential for a monster to come on shore that's going to change our lives forever. And I think that a lot of folks here in Tallahassee, what they've experienced from hurricanes has been some impact. Certainly people have had their homes and properties affected. Many folks without power 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 days. I don't think we really fully as a community understand what months without power and a destroyed infrastructure could look like. And with our proximity to the coast, with major hurricanes threatening the area, certainly will in the future again, we don't know when. I think that's a big takeaway for me, is we need to not plan for you know, what we've experienced. We need to really think and plan for something that changes us all forever.
Heed the instructions of local emergency management and stay up to date with the latest forecasts from your local National Weather Service office. We are all public servants working daily to protect life and property.